Galvano's dream of defeating cancer. West Virginia on top of South Florida as we open the fourth quarter, 20-13. The Mountaineers have the lead in search of a share of the Big East title while the Bulls are trying to win their sixth game and the disappointing second half of the season and become bowl eligible. Third and five for Geno Smith. Pressure coming. The long pass toward Tavon Austin. Austin wanted a flag. None are forthcoming. Jacquez Jenkins on the coverage. It'll be fourth down.
Now, this was balanced coverage on either side of the field. Three on two to the right, three on two to the left. And it's a nice job of the secondary not giving an option for Geno Smith. I thought the middle of the field pre-snap, Jesse, was where the ball was going to go.
You know, Mark Snyder loves Jacquez Jenkins. Young sophomore corner, says he's going to be his free safety next year. Very headsy player. They weren't sure if they could match up with these wide receivers in man-to-man situations tonight. So far, they've held their own weight.
Corey Smith to punt it away. Good protection. Smith rolls it toward Evan Landy, and Landy, good pickup and nifty moves to save a few yards in field position as he's knocked down at the 24. South Florida fired. That made Miami bowl eligible. South Florida is trying to get there. Of course, the Hurricanes not going to the postseason this year as Victor Mark makes the quick catch. Miami deciding in a bit of a preemptive strike to go ahead and not take a bowl bid this year in light of the NCAA investigation.
And they extended Al Golden, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Al's done a nice job down there.
And he has sort of ending some of the speculation about Al Golden's future on a second and one play. Give to Murray on the inside as he picks up the first down. And much like Al Golden, Skip Holtz, also a commodity that has been talked about in some circles and being a viable candidate for some of the openings around the country. South Florida working very hard to tie up Holtz and make him the head coach here in Tampa for a long time.
I think North Carolina is where a lot of folks have rumored that there would be interest, and you could understand that.
Daniels throwing into traffic. It's knocked down by Ian Smith. It'll be second down and 10.
Seen a lot of drop passes tonight from USF wide receivers. How many dropped interceptions have we seen tonight from West Virginia's secondary? This is a bad decision by B.J. Daniels trying to fit the corner throw in. Throws it a little bit behind Victor Mark. That's a play Ian Smith has to make.
I think the throw needs to go underneath. You know, pick up your 6 or 7 yards and go to second and 3.
Instead, it's second and 10. Daniels has it batted down. Julian Miller, who left the game earlier with an ankle injury. Ankle good enough to get up and knock it down and make it 3rd and 10 for the Bulls.
Left tackle Mark Popek getting up very gingerly here after that play. Again, he's been isolated tonight on Julian Miller, on Bruce Irvin, all the best pass rushers from West Virginia. Now a true freshman, Darrell Williams, checks in at left tackle. Let's see how Julian Miller, the sack master right now, with 4 sacks last week against Pittsburgh, he can get upfield.
Roll away from it. Move.
3rd and 10. Miller came to the inside where there was help on him. Landy catches it. Landy gets upfield and makes the first down. We've seen some excellent runs after the catch by a couple of South Florida's receivers tonight. And Skip Holmes' dad always says, teams don't beat you throwing and catching. They beat you by running after they catch.
And Landy now has made several nice plays in this ball game of picking up his quarterback and his offense, extending a series for them. And that getting away from the left side, that was a really nice job of Darrell Williams stepping in the clutch.
Draw. Short game. Najee Good there to stop Murray.
Let's not discount how big a game this is for USF trying to reach a bowl game. They need the extra 15 practices moving forward. We've talked about how young of a team they are. That extra bowl practice allows them to develop leadership. It allows them to develop playmakers.
Daniels threw it behind Murray. It'll be 3rd and 7.
And you know, if Skip Holtz were to leave, those extra 15 days for a new coach would be really important. And so, and I know that's, there's a lot of speculation going on, but I mean, there's a ton of movement going on with the coaching ranks right now.
I think they got South Florida for an illegal shift. So it'll be a 5-yard penalty.
You see B.J. Daniels again picking his team up. Another example of his improved leadership right now, understanding what's on the line, critical juncture of this game in the fourth quarter.
Let me ask you this. Would you have taken that penalty and make it 3rd and 7 had they not, instead of 2nd and 12?
I know offensively I like the opportunity.
Leading the injuries in the booth to the face.
Stuck my face in the fan to get that interception. 3rd and 7 for B.J. Daniels. Against the blitz, he fires it to the freshman Davis, who makes the grab, and the chains are moved.
Yeah, now we've seen Davis now with back-to-back big-time plays. This guy's starting to step up, the true freshman. He's got good hands. The coaching staff says he's got a vertical game to him, but right now working underneath.
You have to win your one-on-one opportunities at wide receiver, and that's the privilege you get as the boundary wide receiver, that split-end position. When you're put one-on-one against the opposing team's best cornerback, you got all that space, you got to win.
At the 37 of West Virginia. They show blitz. Daniels taking a shot. He's got a man wide open for a moment until Smith came over and closed the gap. He hung it up there for a while. Deontay Welch was by himself for a moment, and Smith recovered nicely.
B.J. Daniels needed to dial up the fastball on this throw. You're going to see outside here on the wheel route. Deontay Welch, he's open right now. But that throw has to be on a line, on the back shoulder, to allow his wide receiver to make that catch.
Well, and add one more to your reel of missed opportunities there. Couldn't come down with the interception, and that's one of those chances that Ian Smith wishes he had again.
2nd down and 10. Daniels firing quickly. Welch has it inside the 20. Another 1st down for the Bulls.
Now, remember earlier in this game, Welch stopped on an in route and didn't keep going. This time he did. He stayed on the in course there, and the ball delivered on time.
Again, an example of good yards after the catch for Welch. Being strong, fighting for positive yardage. Look at the second half 1st downs in this game. It's been completely one-sided. USF has been able to sustain drives. Now knocking inside the red zone.
2 turnovers have hurt West Virginia. Daniels can't find anybody. Now B.J. wants to just throw it away, and he does. It'll be 2nd down and 10.
Smart play by B.J. Daniels. In the past, his biggest, I guess the disappointment with B.J. Daniels, the Achilles heel, was that he felt like he could always make the big play. You mentioned 22 interceptions coming into this season. But this year, he's been doing a much better job taking care of the football, being smart, particularly down here in the red zone where you cannot afford an interception.
Back to the ground. Murray inside the 10, carrying Smith with him. He has the 1st down. It's 1st and goal for USF. Play. Demetrius Murray's the running back. Murray has it. He's running on that left side, and he's pushing toward the goal line. He'll be stopped just short, 2nd and goal.
It's the biggest side of South Florida's offensive line behind left guard Jeremiah Warren. It's where the most experience is.
They're snapping it quickly. They give it back to Murray. Murray appears to have broken the plane, but maybe not. Officials are saying no.
Again, you got 4 downs. Take your time. Make sure you got your offensive linemen set. Get up there, and even if you run the same play, let them bull themselves into the end zone. Get big and strong up front. See, your left guard, your left tackle, and your tight end didn't even come off on the count. And that's because you're up there hurrying and doing a herky-jerky. I don't like that.
Well, Ricky Kovacs, the fullback, has just checked in. Big personnel. Here's that T formation we've seen.
That ball was very close to the plane, but it'll be moved. After they snap the ball, and the whole pile goes into the end zone, and B.J. Daniels on the sneak. They're making sure he still has the ball, and if he does, they'll signal touchdown, I believe. They do. Bonani hasn't missed an extra point this season. And he still hasn't. We are the Bulls trying to finish it off by knocking West Virginia out of a share of the Big East title. Tavon Austin will not get an opportunity. This time it'll be Devon Brown. And Brown is knocked down as he crosses at 25. And we go back to the studio in Wendy Nix. Raymond James Stadium, 20-20. Geno Smith and company largely ineffective in the second half. Oh, it's picked off and going the other way. Touchdown, South Florida. It's Jacquez Jenkins. You think Jenkins had been coached up? He knew that one was coming. His second interception of the year, the sophomore from nearby St. Petersburg. And Dana Holgorsen's team has seen its lead vanish. Well, you might have heard some cheering here in Tampa. They're cheering in Cincinnati, too. The Bearcats need a West Virginia loss, and they'll have an opportunity with a victory to go to the BCS.
Number 18, 5-yard penalty. We'll replay the try.
Let's take another look at the pick six by Jenkins.
Mark Snyder said he was going to do something different tonight. He rushes three and dropped eight into coverage, and there was one extra body back there Smith did not account for.
Jacquez Jenkins read that the entire way. He saw the wide receiver outside bubble back and attacked the football all the way into the end zone.
Jenkins, as Jesse mentioned earlier, a guy that Snyder believes is going to be a star here. Made a star-worthy play with that one. Had vision on it, broke on it, and took it to the house. A 24-yard interception return, 13 points off three Mountaineer turnovers. Geno tried to look him off. Jenkins was having none of it. The sophomore scores it, and the Bulls of Skip Holtz have taken a 27-20 lead. Holgorsen. Holgorsen, of course, used to be the offensive coordinator in Houston while Snyder was the head coach at Marshall. The kickoff going to Brown. And Brown, who had a costly turnover earlier in the half, has run out of bounds, and it has been a lot of miscues for the Mountaineers.
Well, the three that you mentioned there are something. This one here was really the turning point of the football game. As the Mountaineers were going in to score the turnover, South Florida went down, kicked the field goal. Then they battled and took it away from them. You just saw the one here that resulted in seven. So this South Florida defense, this entire football game, has kept their ball club in it to the point now they've taken the lead.
Turnovers have not been a strong suit for the Mountaineers this year. Minus two in this game, now minus three for the season. Minus seven on the scoreboard. Pressure coming on Geno Smith. Knocked down. It'll be second and 10, and South Florida's defense is feeling it. Sam Barrington making the play.
This defense is now getting comfortable with the rhythm of West Virginia, and these defensive linemen and linebackers understand that West Virginia's only success for the majority of this game has come over the middle in shallow routes. Defenders now doing a good job getting their hands up, anticipating these throws.
Second down and 10. Smith firing deep to the outside and a fine catch by J.D. Woods. Marking very close to the first down.
I go back to last year, the Marshall game. West Virginia was down big time, and Geno Smith came out and pulled them out of the fire and won that ball game. That night, I remember watching Geno Smith saying, "You are never out of the game as long as Geno Smith is throwing the football. He's accurate and he's competitive."
Third down, a very short one. Mountaineers still in the shotgun. Converted just two times in 11 third down attempts. They'll throw for it on third and a couple feet. Geno taking a shot. Woods is out there, and he can't hold it. And clearly, by taking that shot on third and 2 feet, I got to believe they're going to go for it on fourth down. And I don't see the punting team coming.
It's a risk Dana Holgorsen at this point willing to take. And that is a giant risk. Sean Alston entering the game. We know what to expect. This should be a run.
South Florida's defensive line has had the better of this matchup in the second half. But only half yard to go at most. Big play in this game. Smith fires, first down. Stedman Bailey making the catch out to the 40-yard line. Kayvon Webster on the stop.
This is nothing more than a toss sweep. They are so used. This is pitch and catch. And Bailey pushes off the corner and does a nice job of turning around expecting the ball.
But why is Kayvon Webster giving him so much cushion on fourth and inches? Press him, get up in his face, and contest the throw.
Maybe give your defensive line a chance to get to Smith. They don't get to him again. Tavon Austin catches it, but he'll actually lose yardage. Jenkins was the first guy there. He just had the pick six. It'll be second down and long. Well, as we head inside 8.5 minutes, here's what's at stake for both teams. Mountaineers have to have a win to get a share of the Big East and potentially a BCS berth. The Bulls looking for their seventh straight bowl appearance. Quick pass to Austin. Flag coming in the middle of the field. Austin slips a couple of tackles. It'll be third and long. Penalty pending. It was thrown personal back foul. And holding.
Tripping. Offense. Number 76. 15-yard penalty. First down.
It was thrown in the holding area, but they got the rare tripping call on Joe Madsen.
Mark Snyder defensively now going to contest all throws outside. That last snap, he pressed the outside wide receivers with safety help behind them.
We have not seen a big explosive play out of West Virginia. No. I mean, this offense came in here averaging over 6.4 yards per snap. I mean, this is a very high potent offense. Mark Snyder's defense kept everything in front of them, and most importantly, they've made tackles one-on-one in open space.
They're going to need explosive plays now. The 15-yard penalty has them 27 yards away from a first down. Try to get some of it back on second with Garrison, who gets back up to the 35-yard line. That'll leave him about 16 yards short of first down.
Remember, West Virginia has used all of their timeouts in this half. If South Florida can force a punt and get the football back, they have an opportunity to bleed a lot of clock.
Expect a three-man rush and dropping a lot of folks.
West Virginia has been abysmal on third down tonight. Nine in coverage, only two rushing, so Smith has all kinds of time. He completes the pass to Bailey, but well short of the first down, and there is another flag down.
May have been a punch thrown there.
Personal foul. Hands at the face. Defense. Number 97. 15-yard penalty. Automatic. First down.
That is a costly penalty against Ryan Giddens.
Yeah, you know what? This is frustration. You know, this is a blow to the head. That's a senseless play by an athlete losing his composure. You've got a third and a busload. You've got nine in coverage. There's no way they're going to convert.
It's only a sophomore. Another example of a young player making a crucial mistake. And it's happened to this football team all season long. The lack of seniority and the lack of leadership has been a giant problem for USF.
That mistake can't be made by a player of any age.
Composure.
Yeah, no question.
So West Virginia's been given an opportunity. Can they do something with it?
Terrible play by Giddens gives West Virginia a first down at the 40. Geno Smith. Feeling some pressure from Barrington. Geno runs away with it, and he'll pick up some good yardage and dance out of bounds at about the 32-yard line. It'll be second and two.
Such an advantage in Dana Holgorsen's offense to have a quarterback that can keep plays alive. I think back to 2009 with Case Keenum, something he did an outstanding job when he was at Houston playing for Dana Holgorsen. Oklahoma State didn't really have that element with Brandon Weeden, but Geno Smith here coming up with big plays with his legs.
Can't believe you would question Brandon Weeden's foot speed.
Well, Brandon may even go along with him on that.
Second and two for Geno Smith. He fires to the outside, grabbed nicely by Ivan McCartney. McCartney, a guy who's tailed off a little bit in the latter stages of the season, but he makes a huge catch.
Okay, so because Geno Smith was able to run and have some effectiveness, that changed Snyder's call. He brought 4 and 5 that time, making sure he can contain and keep Smith in the pocket.
He's going to have players spying Geno Smith here at this area of the field.
West Virginia with a 1st and 10. It's been a disastrous second half for the Mountaineers with 3 turnovers. It's cost them the lead.
Comes a run.
South Florida in the neutral zone. Garrison's in the secondary. Garrison inside the 20. He was wrestled down by Jarrell Young, who was trying to strip the ball away late.
Number 94. Kelly's a climb. He's on the play. First down.
Geno Smith doing a good job right here. They're using just a silent count. And again, just another mistake up front by Juju Forte on the outside.
West Virginia's had trouble in the red zone tonight, particularly from this area. It's 1st and goal. Garrison has it. Garrison, no trouble into the end zone, and West Virginia enters. And an extra point away from another tie.
Remember, at one point on this drive, it was 2nd and 27 for West Virginia. They're able to take advantage of mistakes by USF, and the true freshman, Dustin Garrison, almost untouched, tying into the end zone.
Tyler Rader, Joe Mattson did a fantastic job of combo blocking coming off so that no one was free to hit the ball carrier, Garrison.
Bittencourt puts through the extra point to tie it, and to Jesse's point, if not for that personal foul penalty, the hands to the face by Ryan Giddens, the Bulls had forced a 4th down. The Mountaineers were probably going to try to go for it. There was the punch. Here's the result. Dustin Garrison hoping to lift West Virginia to a BCS game. Trying to win a share of the Big East and what the Mountaineers plan to be their final year in the Big East. They're tied with South Florida at 27. Just over 5 minutes to go. Lindsey Lamar has it. Lamar gives him a little dead leg. And now his legs are live. They're waving him down the sidelines. Lamar with a tremendous return. Knocked down by Corey Smith, the kicker. And the Bulls are set up in excellent field position with the explosive play from number 5.
Special teams have been the Achilles heel for South Florida all game long. In the kicking game, allowing a long kickoff return, touchdown. Now Lindsey Lamar again. Last year's Big East Special Teams Player of the Year, making an impact play, giving the football back to B.J. Daniels, almost at the 40-yard line of the opposition here with about 5 minutes to go.
Lamar used that right stick to give him a little juke and turned on the speed.
Dead and then brought it alive.
It's the R1 button in PlayStation.
Yeah. I don't know about that.
53 yards on the return. South Florida will start it on the ground with Demetrius Murray. For just joining us, Darryl Scott, lead back for the Bulls, left with a shoulder injury. Demetrius Murray and Marcus Shaw have been carrying the load. B.J. Daniels has thrown it 43 times tonight for more than 200 yards. It was a defensive touchdown that gave the Bulls the lead, and then West Virginia answered to score and tied at 27.
And remember, now coming into this ballgame, we didn't even know if B.J. Daniels would play. He had the bruised shoulder, the AC joint there. So, I mean, for him, he stepped up and throwing it with a lot of accuracy.
44 throws complete to Victor Mark. Mark spins down to the 35-yard line. He'll be 4 yards short of the 1st down.
In the second half, we've seen young wide receivers start stepping up and making plays. Andre Davis, Deontay Welsh, 2 freshmen. Here's a critical down and distance. 3rd and 4, the game on the line. There's going to be a contested throw somewhere here. Make a play.
2 down territory, though. They do not want to give this ball back. They're playing for a bold bid, for an opportunity to move and extend this season. So there's going to be 2 plays here. They're not going to punt the football back.
They're close to Mike Abunani's field goal range. He has a 49-yarder. He hit it against Notre Dame earlier this season. Daniels, a rare run. B.J. has the first down, and he'll slide down to protect that shoulder. New set of downs as the clock winds down toward 3.5 to go.
Showing you intelligence and game management again. By not running out of bounds, he keeps the game clock running right now. Oh, protecting himself, yes, but also ensuring that the final possession might be USF's here at the end of this game.
And Todd Fitch, the offensive coordinator, should not put that play right there away on this series. Keep it in his back pocket, pull it out here in another couple of plays to see if West Virginia will stay outside and contain him.
B.J. Daniels will bleed the play clock all the way down to the last possible second.
On first and 10, Daniels run it again. Now Daniels fumbled the football. In West Virginia, I believe, they have it. They do. Najee Good stripped it away from Daniels, who didn't have the thing put away, and a turnover this time against South Florida. Doug Rigg with the recovery.
Najee Good is the undisputed leader of this football team. And for him to step up and strip this football is symbolic of the fight of these Mountaineers. Ball just gets a little away from the pocket. He didn't have it high and tight and tucked over there.
B.J. Daniels all game long had been doing a good job of securing the football, not trying to do too much with that injured shoulder. You see right here, 3 points of pressure needed. You cannot try and swim a defender with the football in the same hand. And now Geno Smith, without any timeouts, can he orchestrate in a two-minute situation, put his team in field goal range for a potential win and a potential BCS berth?
Three-man look up front. South Florida going to drop back in coverage, keep everything in front of them, inviting the run.
And they get it. Dustin Garrison. Garrison who scored the touchdown. There's a flag down. South Florida perhaps got caught jumping.
Dustin Garrison.
Jeff McConney is wanting to know if the result of the play is a first down.
How composed Dana Holgorsen is there on the sidelines here at this play call.
Offside. Defense. Number 94. Kelly's decline. Second down. Please reset the game clock to 2:54. 2:54. On the game clock.
I'm always so amazed with head coaches that can call plays on offense from the field. You just have to have a feel for the game. Guys like Steve Spurrier at South Carolina, Paul Johnson, Georgia Tech, Chip Kelly at Oregon. Dana Holgorsen, one of those guys, just has a feel for it.
Paul Johnson, another one of those. It's amazing from the field how he sees it and calls it.
Sending some heat this time. Smith fires to Woods. First down, West Virginia. Woods up across the 45 to the 46-yard line. Jacquez Jenkins on the stop.
But I think Dana's a whole lot like Paul Johnson. They're more concerned with themselves and their execution and what they're trying to accomplish. He knows the opportunities are there if his receivers run the right routes.
They'd have to get to the 28-yard line to match the season long for Tyler Bittencourt.
Clock running. No timeouts remaining for West Virginia. Garrison. Short gain on first down. They still move the pile. Finally, the whistle comes in.
You see, though, what's happening here. South Florida's showing a three-man rush, a walk-around, inviting the run, but their linebackers are quick with a foot in the ground to support against the run.
West Virginia's running game now coming to the rescue again late in games. It did against Pittsburgh last week in the backyard brawl, big win. They're running the football with success these last two drives.
Inside 2 minutes to go, a second and six.
Look at that soft bubble right there. Three-man, look at the linebackers.
It's two
depth.
Bubbles, yeah.
Yeah, it's two bubbles.
Garrison has it. Garrison has the first down. He's inside the 45. Clock will stop long enough to move the chains with 1:36 to go.
You got
to
change it up if you're Mark Snyder now. Put at least one more body up front. Make it an even look for defensive linemen, because right now West Virginia carving away into those big bubble looks we keep seeing. They're going to line up with more bubbles again right here.
They're going to call a run.
12 to 14 more yards to give Tyler Bittencourt a chance based on his career long of 45 yards. Geno Smith. Plenty of time, and now he runs out, and Smith takes a sack. Clock still running. Holgorsen wanting some urgency.
critical mistake by Geno Smith. He knows better than that to take a sack on this play. The reason he takes the sack, it's a coverage sack. Fantastic coverage downfield. Quinton Washington on blanket outside.
Okay, now guys, clock's still running. Second and 19, West Virginia trying desperately to get into field goal range. Only two rushing. A lot of guys in coverage. Clock still running. Smith fires complete. Bailey makes the catch, but the clock is going to continue to run. Didn't get out of bounds. Third down coming.
Now they can rush three and drop again, but they've got to put pressure on this quarterback. Geno Smith, you can't cover a receiver that long.
Third and 10. Pressure almost intercepted. It'll be fourth down with 13 seconds to go. There's a flag down on the play on the near side. The 22-yard line of the Bulls. West Virginia had a player eavesdropping. He applauded. This could be a costly penalty against the Bulls. Jeff McConaughey, the referee in the white hat, sorting it out with his crew. 13 seconds to go. West Virginia trying to get into field goal range. Perhaps kick a field goal that would give them a share of the Big East title and keep their hopes of making a BCS game alive. That's Tyler Bittencourt, the kicker. He's been a clutch kicker. He's got tremendous technique. Maybe not the biggest leg in the world, but a couple of game-winning field goals in his career.
Geno Smith telling his offense right now, if they get another crack at this, get ready for a clock it situation. If they can muster up another completion to provide an opportunity for a game-winning field goal.
2009, Bittencourt made one as time expired to beat Pittsburgh.
Legal substitution, defense. 5-yard penalty. We paid the down.
Well, I tell you what, that's really for Skip Holtz. He's sitting there thinking, it could have been, we're all thinking pass interference, something bigger than that.
Well, I saw the guy running off the field. I didn't see the flag respond initially. It appeared that he got close to the sideline. He was sprinting off.
Well, right now,
with the penalty,
they need to be concerned about getting to the line of scrimmage and getting ready for this next snap. Call time and get organized.
Use their final timeout.
Absolutely. The right call there.
They're going to. It looks as if there's going to.
After further review, the 11th player was leaving the field. That's a legal play. Therefore, there is no substitution foul. The result of the play was an incomplete pass. The ball he plays at the 42-yard line, fourth down.
Ooh, what a call.
So the guys upstairs do a good job and get it right. The same as the 11th player leaving the field. I have to go back and look again. Did they play that play with 10 guys? Is that what they're saying?
Yeah. Well, a lot of folks interested in this game. You think Butch Jones and Cincinnati are watching this?
I think so, but now let's reset the situation here, guys. Now, because there was no penalty, it's fourth down rather than third. They're at the 42-yard line. Got to get the first down. Also need to get inside the 35 to give Bittencourt a chance. Geno Smith, fire. He's got his man, Stedman Bailey. 7 seconds to go. They'll have to clock it quickly. West Virginia in a mess. They get it clocked.
Chemistry so important between a quarterback and wide receiver. When you have to have a play, you go to the guy you trust the most. Geno Smith and Stedman Bailey have been playing football together for the last 6 years, dating back to Miramar High School. Are you kidding me?
What a grab on fourth down by Bailey. And now Bittencourt trying for his third game-winning field goal in his career. It'll be from 33 yards out, and here's a flag.
Ooh.
Illegal substitution. Defense. 5-yard penalty.
Inexcusable.
Replay, yeah. First down.
It's inexcusable.
Well, I'll tell you what that does. That really takes away from the ability for this ball to hook and be wide left or right. And the mistakes, again, costing USF here late in this game, throughout the game.
Now from 28 yards, Bittencourt trying to give West Virginia a share of the Big East title.
Skip Holtz is going to ice him.
And Holtz uses his final timeout.
You know what? I had said, you know, this was one of those deals to where throwing back to the middle of the field, Geno Smith, and you saw the move on the outside. Bailey made it look like he was going to be over there. They had it really bunched up on the sidelines. And what a throw back to the middle of the field to Bailey.
I remember Tyler Bettencourt earlier in this game in the first quarter had an attempt from 38 yards that hit the right upright. This one, a much shorter attempt. Ball is on the 11-yard line. The holder will put the ball down at the 18, making it a 28-yard attempt. He is on the left hash.
2 weeks in a row, boys, with walk-off kicks.
Texas had one. Let's see if West Virginia does. Bettencourt for the game, and it is good. Stedman Bailey getting some congratulations, and boy, does he deserve it. Cincinnati heartbroken as West Virginia stays alive for a BCS berth. The Mountaineers, with a Bearcat win over UConn on Saturday, will almost certainly go to a BCS game as the highest ranked team in the BCS from the Big East.
Give West Virginia a lot of credit. Time and time again this season, they've found a way to come from behind, fight through adversity, and find a win. A tremendous game-ending drive engineered by Geno Smith. A big-time catch by Stedman Bailey, setting up this game-winning field goal by Tyler Bettencourt.
And for South Florida, the third time this season, they lose a game on the final play, and that doesn't include Zach Collaros scoring a touchdown with about 12 seconds to go to win. It's been that kind of year for South Florida, and it's a winning night for Geno Smith and the Mountaineers. As we check in with Jen Brown, who has Dana Holgorsen with her.
Thanks, Reese. Coach, you seem so calm over there on the sidelines, but what was going through your head as your offense drive the field there and made that game-winning field goal?
Yeah, there's really no time to think, you know, and I'm just proud of these guys. This is the third week in a row that it's came down to the last minute, and well, what this team's figured out is just to find a way to win. You know, for 3 weeks in a row, they've just found a way to win.
Well, finding a way to win tonight gives you a share of the Big East title. You said that was your goal coming into this season as your first head coaching role. What does this win mean?
It means a lot to the kids. It means a lot.
Get a little bat there.
Yeah, it's always fun. That's the first one of those, but
mine too.
It was our goal, you know, and the guys just kept playing. They kept playing the whole game, and I'm proud of them.
You're going to get 15 extra days with your team to set up what could possibly be for a BCS Bowl series, depending on the Saturday game with UConn and Cincinnati. What do you need to work on in those 15 days to get ready for that?
Well, offensively, we need to work on a lot, you know, and which we will, you know, and this is still relatively early in the process when it comes to this type of offense for these type of kids. But we'll keep working at it. There's a lot of things that we can work on, which we will.
All right, go enjoy yourself. Enjoy the win. Thanks, Coach Reese.
All right, Jen. So Dana Holgorsen now waits and hopes that Cincinnati can beat UConn. In that case, they would make their way to the BCS almost certainly. Our Wrangler five-star player of the game is Dustin Garrison. Garrison only 88 yards rushing on the night, but 54 of those and a touchdown came on the last two drives. The game-tying touchdown drive and then the drive that led to the game-winning field goal. Dustin Garrison, our Wrangler five-star player of the game. If indeed that is West Virginia's final game in the Big East and that's still to be settled in the legal system, what a thriller it was for Geno Smith and the Mountaineers, 30-27 over South Florida. That's our final. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Jen Brown, and our entire fabulous crew, both in the truck and on the field, who've done such a wonderful job all season long, we're saying good night from Tampa, Florida. West Virginia gets a share of the Big East, 30-27. SportsCenter coming your way now.